Okay, so what we're going to look at here is the second moment of area. And the unfortunate part about second moment of area is usually when you see it in statics, they're like, calculate the second moment of area, and we're going to move on to other things. And you're like, but wait a second, why am I actually using this? It's kind of weird, and it's just like a geometric property. And sure, why not? But seriously, why am I doing this? So here's kind of like the not full version of why you're doing all this. If you really, really want to know everything, you need to take a class called Mechanics of Materials, and you'll get into that a whole lot more. Okay, but basically the idea is you've got stuff that you got to know how to do. And in order to be successful in mechanical materials, so basically what we do is we show it to you in statics so that whenever you get to mechanics materials, you're like, so remember second moment of area, blah, 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 blah. And you're like, oh, that's why I did that. So let's try to get you that far now so you at least have some context of what you're doing. So second moment of area, we'll talk about why it's called second moment in a little while, but it's not going to become obvious until we actually derive the whole thing. So I have a picture here of a beam, and it's under a load. But the thing is, you can't tell by looking at it from the front, but if you look at it from the side, this is the cross-section. And in the cross-section, it's actually an I-beam. Okay? Now, in some other version of, or other, some other part of statics, you've gone in here and drawn some kind of a moment diagram, and whatever, some kind of a moment diagram. Okay? So basically what you've figured out is, and this is, would not be what this would look like at all, but it's okay. You've got some kind of a moment diagram that's saying that there's some kind of bending happening on this, or a moment reaction happening upon this at any given time. So that if I cut the beam off here, I would have a bending moment this way. Whether it's positive or negative, if I cut the beam off, I'd have some kind of bending reaction moment. Okay, got it? Very exciting. Not question mark. It's not reaction moment, it's like reaction moment. Yay! Okay, so you have this bending reaction moment. Now, this is not too weird to describe this as, but instead of calling it a reaction moment, what I could do is say, well, what if I got super duper duper close, and instead of having a reaction moment around the z-axis, what if I rewrote that particular thing as a force here and a force here? As a couple moment. Okay? Kind of seeing this? Or, yeah, just like that. And in fact, if I wanted to do this, I could kind of do this infinitely, because in real life, that's what's happening. And so what I mean by that is this. In real life, whenever you have a beam and it's trying to bend, it bends around what's called the neutral axis. Neutral. That looks really weird. The word neutral looks weird, doesn't it? Neutral axis. So whenever you're bending around the neutral axis, what happens is, it does it on purpose, but basically there's this thing in the geometric center of the cross-section, where that's going to stay the stillest, but everything else is going to kind of bend up or bend down. And I'll just draw a picture of the bending up part, just for funsies. But basically what you have is you have something that's bending up around the neutral axis. And theoretically it's neutral because in real life there's not much movement. I'm just really super duper exaggerating it. But really what happens is it's pretty much not visible, except there's just this tiny wiki wonk here and this tiny wiki wonk here. I'm just making it super, super tight here. But essentially if I looked at any kind of a section of the beam, and again this is still the XY axis, that if I had this section here, that whenever I got here, it would look like that, right? So this is kind of exaggerated, but essentially what would happen is as it is getting bent, that what's happening on the front is this is getting smaller, and this here on the bottom is getting bigger, okay? So essentially what's happening on top is it's in compression, and on the top, it's in compression, and on the bottom, it's in tension. All right, does that make sense? Okay, so back to this picture here. What I can say is that this little force thing that I've got cut off here is I've actually got a whole lot of forces here on the outside. That's where my maximum compression and maximum tension are, and then slightly less, and then slightly less, and so on. And that's what that bending moment looks like. All right, so basically, if I'm moving away from my neutral axis, this is again my neutral, weird looking word, my neutral axis, that the pressure increases as I go away. Increases as you go up or down. Does that make sense? So essentially what I could do is I could name some just random constant gamma times y. So that would be, because remember this was, whenever I had my little axis, this was like, doo-doop, this was, what do we call it, y and x, except this is the negative x side. Anyway, whenever I would say that the pressure increases with y, so the further up I am from y, I've got a positive force, and it doesn't really matter if it's plus or minus, because it just depends on the direction of the moment, so we'll just leave it kind of generic, is that as I move away from the neutral axis, that the pressure is going to increase. Okay, so we'll leave it at that for the moment. So this is the pressure as we go up or down. Now it is important to note that it always is going to bend around the neutral axis. So this is always assuming that this neutral axis is going through the cross section. So if we have a beam that looks like that, that would be the neutral axis. If we had the I-beam, that would be the neutral axis. If I had a triangle beam, that would be the neutral axis, because that's the easiest place for it to bend around. It would be super, super weird if somehow it bent around this. Some other kind of major constraint would have to be going on, or it'd have to be made of a non-uniform material, which is totally, totally beyond the scope of statics. So if we're just looking at the mechanics of it, it is going to bend. If we have something that's made out of all the same thing, it's going to actually bend around the center. Okay? Good. Now, I've got this lovely picture here, and this is a picture of a beam, and we're going to pretend it's cut off so that the rest of the beam kind of goes like this. So here's the rest of the beam, and I've cut it off. Now, I've originally drawn it with the axis to make it consistent with our regular axis, where we usually have some kind of a beam under some kind of a distributed load, where we had X and Y. But unfortunately, that's not what we're going to use. We're going to kind of change the names around, and that's just to be consistent with what you're going to see in all the other books. Is what we're actually going to do is I'm going to switch it around. So normally whenever I see this cross-section, the cross-section axes are also labeled X and Y, because you're like, thanks, I don't have enough to worry about with you switching axes on me. So what we're going to do is I'm going to relabel this 3D diagram. So for this to be X and Y, then that means that X actually has to go this direction. X has to go this direction. Y is this direction. And if you use your right hand rule, I'm using my hand above my screen like you could possibly see what I'm doing. But I have X, Y, and then this guy is going to become Z. So that's going to be my new axis. It just looks funny without that there. I'm just choo-choo. All right, so X, Y, and Z. So really what this means now is instead of having this, it would be Z and Z. Like that, so you'd have, that looks really bad, you would have W of Z, so distributed load in terms of Z. All right, so I've got this, and now we still have these forces, or these pressures. So basically we have this pressure kind of coming across here, and the pressure is super high here. Well, these have actually drawn as forces, and let's talk about that. So basically if I have a certain pressure, I don't have a really good way of distributing there, that's a nice fat pressure. So I have pressure, low pressure, except the pressure is really going the other direction. But anyway, you get the point. But the way that I can convert pressure into force, right, is by area. So if I look at this little area right here, so I've got this nice little area, some kind of D area, and I know that there is a certain pressure. So there's a pressure, or sorry, I have the D area. I know that if I take D area and multiply it by the pressure, then that should give me the force, right? So area we'll just say is in, say, meters squared. Pressure is going to be newtons per area, right? Because pressure is force over area. So if I multiply force over area times area, I get force. So the units check out, so that's good. So basically what I can do is I can replace all those teeny-weeny pressures with one teeny-weeny force that acts down the center. Like that. So it'd be kind of acting down that center line. And that's what we're going to see here. So I'm going to redraw my cross section down here. All right. And now there's really no reason that our cross-section has to be a beautiful, lovely square beam, so I'm going to make my cross-section like that. And, well, do-do-do-do-do-do. All right, and the only thing that was required is that that z-axis has to come through the centroid. All right, and so essentially now what I can do is I can change all the pressures on here into all of the d forces. Okay, so now what I can do is I can look at the moment, the D moment, caused by that D force, and the D moment caused by that D force is, well, the height is, right, Y. So the D moment about the X axis caused by that D force is Y DF. And because I'm super, super awesome at, you know, basic calculus, and here it's just calculus, since I'm super, super awesome at calculus, I can say, well, that means that MX is going to be, well, it's going to be the integral of y df. And I can replace df with this thingy I had before, which was that thing. So dA mu or rho dy. And that's not a rho, that's a gamma. Y dA. So then I do some math, and since I said that was a constant, I can pull it out. And my y is going to vary from, I don't know, well, I guess it would actually depend, so I don't actually know that. But anyway, this is the integral that we're actually concerned about. So this here is the special integral, it's the magic integral. This is the integral that gives us the moment of the second moment of area. Okay, so that is the integral for the second moment of area, and we call it I. So in this case, we call it I sub x because it's for the moment. But essentially what we have is that we have I x is equal to the integral y squared dA. Okay, so that's the second moment of area around the x axis. And so basically what this is doing is this is predicting how much resistance you're going to get to bending around the x axis. Does that make sense? Okay, so that's the measure of how much bending you're going to get around the x-axis. Now, I can also find Iy the exact same way. It's going to give me the same equations, and that's going to be bending around y. And in the idea of our distributed load, that doesn't really make as much sense because you're not going to be bending around the y, but if you had some kind of super awesome beam diagram where you had, forces here, a distributed load here, and then you had a distributed load like kind of this direction, then you would get bending around the Y. But in any case, we're going to keep that because we are going to play around with it. And again, the purpose in statics is to just get you comfortable calculating these and not actually doing anything with it. Now, I told you like a bazillion years ago that I was going to show you why we call this the second moment. And the reason that we call it the second moment is actually because there's that two right there. So there is a first moment of area. First moment. The first moment. And that's just going to look like that instead of the squared on it. But I don't even want you to write that down because that would be weird. And I don't want you to get it confused. But then you also have like the third moment, which would be y cubed or y cubed instead of y squared. And so it's called the second moment because the y squared is on there. Now let's talk units right quick. So we have, I'll do this one again, I'll just rewrite it. All right, so we have the integral, I sub x is the integral y squared dA. Now y squared is, let's just call it say meters squared, and area is in meters squared as well. So this answer is going to be in some kind of units to the fourth, which is good to know. It is always positive. Something else to note is that the higher the IX, so yeah, the higher the IX, the greater the resistance to bending around the x-axis. All right. And so again, you can actually calculate, and we'll do this in a different video, but you can actually calculate. So if the axis is about the x-axis, this is kind of the centroid, and this is going to be, it, whether it's high or low, this is your lowest point. It'll actually be, if I calculated an IX around this axis, it would be a lot bigger, because basically here, if I'm going to bend around this axis, I have an equal amount of mass on each side to get to kind of wrap around, for lack of a better way of talking about it. And if I'm trying to, say, bend around this guy, which again makes no sense, because it's always going to bend around the easiest way, all of this has to get around, which is going to take a lot more effort than just kind of spinning in a circle. And you just have experience with that. You know, it's easier to get something to spin than it is to grab it and kind of heave it around. And so you always are going to bend around that center axis. It's just you can calculate it about other axes, and there's a reason to do so. It just doesn't have any actual meaning in this kind of a context. Now, I did promise to briefly mention why we do this. And so essentially what you have is this other formula out there that calculates bending stress. And bending stress at any given time is going to be given by something called sigma, my over I. And so basically what that means is if I have this force coming around here, what I would do is I would, this isn't a very good picture, but what I could do is if I wanted to find the maximum stress that would go on, I would again look at this cross section and what the Y means. And if you have a symmetric system, then the Y is just the same thing on both sides. But the Y would be the max distance from the center to where, to the top end. So just to see where it's going to bend. So up in there way, way further along, it'd be the compression or the tension. So you would basically have to find this for the top and the bottom. So you say, well, why have it be Y or whatever? Because is it always going to be the same? And well, it's like, no, because you could actually have something that was drawn like this, where the center is, you know, there, and maybe this could be like 1, but then this would be 2, so the bending stress wouldn't be equal on either side. But essentially what you're going to do is you're going to take the maximum moment that is the beam is put under. And I'm really just going to do this in units because this is way beyond the scope of statics. I just want you to understand why it's in meters to the fourth and what it even means. But you have something that's in Newton meters, and then Y is in meters, and then you're dividing by something that's in meters to the fourth. So that's going to get you something in newtons per meter squared, which is pressure, but it's also stress. And so basically what you're getting is what is the stress on the beam, pounds per square foot, pounds per square inch, PSI, but you're getting the stress on the beam. And so again, the greater that I is, the smaller that number is going to be because you're dividing by a bigger and bigger number. So the bigger your I is, the smaller the total stress, the more resistance it has to bending. So the smaller it is, then the bigger stress that you're going to have. And so that's why you kind of have that inverse relationship. So again, this is kind of like super way beyond the scope of statics, but I just want you to have some kind of a context to understand that precisely why it is that the higher the X, the greater the resistance. It's because eventually we're going to be dividing by that number. And it's essentially a very, very simple geometric kind of weighted average of how much area is away from the center. And so we'll do a whole lot more where we actually calculate this, but this is just to get you some context to get started.